Hey folks, this is Sebastian. Welcome to the third and final part of our short series on how to measure frequency spectra with your smartphone. Today we will determine the rotation frequency of the engine of a car, the rotation frequency of a hard disk drive, and we will have a look at the alias effect and how it can mess with your measurement results. After looking at the audio spectrum and the magnetic spectrum, today is all about the acceleration spectrum. If you missed the other two videos, you might want to check them out first, because they go through a few basics and explain what's going on here today. As the name suggests, the acceleration spectrum is not that different from the other two, except that it uses the accelerometer instead of the microphone or the magnetometer as a data source, which means that it's really great at picking up vibrations. Let's start with the combustion engine. They propel your car by a fast series of internal explosions, so they are loud, smelly, and, of course, they vibrate. And most cars come with a handy display to compare the current measurement to. But there are two minor difficulties here. For engines, we usually do not give the rotation frequency in Hertz, which is per second, but in RPM, which is rotations per minute. But that's just a factor 60 in there. The other thing is that there may be a factor between the vibration frequency and the rotation frequency of your engine. The reason is that an engine is made up of multiple cylinders that do not ignite at the same time. Instead, for example, for this typical four-cylinder straight engine here, they ignite in sequence with two pairs of pistons moving in sync. So this car has a factor of 2 in between, and you should not be surprised if the vibration of your car has a multiple of the actual RPM of your engine. You can do the same with the washing machine to check if it actually spins as fast as it should. And here you should not get a factor, as the vibration is the direct result of an unavoidable imbalance in the drum. Finally, let's have a look at one last example. A hard disk drive. Not a modern solid state disk, but the good old spinning ones. If I place my phone on top, we get a frequency of 120 Hz, which matches what the manufacturer claims as the factor 60 matches the advertised 7200 rotations per minute. Also, we can beautifully see how the disk spins up in the history graph. Now, here comes a strange thing. If we place a different phone on the disk, we get a very different result of 20 Hz. Why is that? This is the so-called alias effect, and it depends on the sample rate of the sensor. My Pixel 3 here has a sample rate of 400 Hz. For the vibration signal of the hard disk spinning at 120 Hz, it means that there are a bit more than 3 data points per rotation to resolve the vibration. Now, if the phone only had a sample rate of 200 Hz, there would not even be 2 points per period. In general, we cannot see the real vibration curve. What we see is only the momentary acceleration for each sample from the sensor. And in this example, those could have also been created by an 80 Hz signal. The vibration is a different one, but because of the slow sample rate, we cannot distinguish those. In fact, that is why the spectrum only goes to half the sampling rate of the sensor. Any higher frequency would look like a lower one, due to the alias effect. For this phone here, it is actually even worse. It only has a sample rate of 100 Hz, so it cannot even resolve 80 Hz. Instead, to this phone, the hard disk looks like 20 Hz. So you always need to keep in mind that higher frequencies can be very misleading. Some phones use higher sampling rates internally and filter those higher frequencies, but quite often it looks just like a valid measurement, like in this example of a VFox user from the US. He expected to see the 60 Hz signal of the US utility frequency, but he saw 40 Hz instead. In this case, the magnetometer of his phone probably has a sample rate of 100 Hz.
Now that's it for this three-part series. I hope you enjoyed it, and if you want to learn more about VFox and other experiments you can do with your phone, check out VFox.org. If you want to support us in one way or another, check out VFox.org/contribute, where we have a list of things that would really help us out. So check out the links in the video description. Thanks for watching, and see you soon in another video.